Good morning. Would you stand with me as we make the declaration? Isaiah's prophecy in chapter 9. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Amen. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice. From this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will complete this. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Amen. Zechariah's prophecy in Luke 1. Blessed is the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hands of all who hate us. Amen. To perform the mercies promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. To grant that we have been delivered from the hands of our enemies, that we might serve the Lord without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our lives. Angel speaks to Mary in Luke chapter 1. The angel said to Mary, do not be afraid, for behold, you will bring forth a son. You will conceive in your womb, and you will bring forth a son, and he shall be called Jesus. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob, and the favor of the Lord will be upon him, and the kingdom of God will be no end. We declare that this morning, Lord God. Revelation chapter 1, Jesus said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, who is and was and is to come, the Almighty, the Lord God Almighty. We just say yes, Lord, today. We say yes to this word from your prophets, God. We say yes and amen. Let your mighty kingdom come. Let your mighty will be done in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Hallelujah. I'll raise a hallelujah. I'll raise a hallelujah. I'll raise a hallelujah. Joy to the world.
Now he rules. you know that your baby boy, when one day you walk on water, Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Your baby boy will give sight to the blind man. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his head? Didn't you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? Will you kiss your little baby? You kiss the face of God. Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know?
It never stopped. In fact, it can happen in here today, because it never stopped and never stopped. Oh. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleepy child you're holding is the great.
Hear the prayer. would dare believe, now it's reality.
Can't count on
oh, how many broken men given a second chance, sealed and lifted hands.
Can't count on
and how many torments down in our promises, standing here now convinced.
How many people have you brought to life? How many people have you restored? How many people have you forgiven? Uncountable. Like the sands of the sea or the stars in the sky. You, Lord, are able. We honor you this morning. We honor you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We remember your goodness and faithfulness. You are able to save to the uttermost, O God. On the edge of death, under the condemnation of disease, Lord, you save anyway. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we come.
Ghost. You deliver out of darkness. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You're so good. You've met us here this morning. Thank you, Jesus. We love you. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Most of you know that I took the position of director in training for the TLC last January, and this January, I will be set in as a director. I want to talk to you about how this is a puzzle piece in my testimony of deliverance. When Mom first started talking about retiring from the pantry, I did not see myself taking this position and certainly didn't want it. I was an introvert, didn't like public speaking, didn't really like the public or crowds or talking to people. But I didn't want a 20-year vision to die. I hesitantly and reluctantly took the position for that reason and that reason only. To my amazement, when I said yes to it, I immediately had a passion for it. I started setting meetings to different ones in the community, sharing my vision, my dream for the future of the pantry. I started working there on Wednesdays and meeting and greeting and talking to the patrons. But I was an introvert, didn't like public speaking, the public, crowds, talking to people. The Holy Spirit just recently revealed to me that that was a lie that was attached to my old identity. When I was delivered from an identity lifestyle 3 years ago, my identity in Christ was set and settled in me. But for God, my identity was set before the foundations of the world. Whew. Jeremiah 1:4-9, the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I set you apart and appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Oh, Lord God, I said, I surely do not know how to speak, for I am only a child. But the Lord told me, do not say I am only a child, for to everyone I send you, you must go, and all that I command you, you must speak. Do not be afraid of them. For I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. Then the Lord reached out his hand, touched my mouth, and said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. Hallelujah. Psalms 139:13-16. For you formed my inmost beings. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and I know this very well. I know this very well now. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All my days were written in your book and ordained for me before one of them came to be. I realize that I'm right now exactly who I was always created to be. That old life had me bound up, captive, isolated to lies that I believed about myself. But my life had already been ordained, written down, spoken. The enemy comes after identity, because when we know who we are in Christ, he is defeated. When we know who we are in Christ, the enemy is defeated. Come on, do we need some defeat right now? Woo! Okay, I'm gonna get back to it. I believe this is a journey. I believe this is part of our pursuit of being whole and holy. Would the elders come? Is welcome to come. Bring your kids. If you'll start in these lines, these aisles here, make your way and around the sides back to your seats.
How many
Talk about two more people real quick whose identity was set before the foundations of the world. John the Baptist and Jesus our Savior. Luke 1:8-17. One day while Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And at the hour of the incense offering, the whole congregation was praying outside. Just then an angel of the Lord appeared to Zechariah, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and gripped for fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, because your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He shall never take wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. Many of the sons of Israel he will turn back to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Wow. The angel of the Lord gave Zechariah a descriptive narrative of John's life, his purpose, his journey. I bet that one was written in the book, you know? And then down verse 26, "In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin pledged in marriage to a man named Joseph, who was of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. The angel appeared to her and said, 'Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you.' Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. So the angel told her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Behold, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." We're still living in that. His kingdom will never end. I know that one's written in the book. Our Savior came to us in the flesh, lived out his purpose, and we are here today knowing our Father did the very same with us. Predestined our path and our purpose, and wrote it in his book. Father, we come to you today to say thank you for your unwavering, unconditional love for us, to have a purpose for us that you already put in motion before we even thought about here on earth. We are in awe of and so grateful for. And we say thank you for sending your Son to us to reveal these things to us and to save us from our adversary. Thank you that you are with us always on this journey to knowing you and knowing who you have created us to be. This understanding, this revelation, us knowing who we are in Christ is a nail in the enemy's coffin. Let's stick it to him in the name of Jesus.
God has been truly grateful and good to us. Christmas came early to Grace. We have Pastor Don Pope with us. Good morning. Hallelujah. And Candy Sweer was released from the hospital, recovering at home. Hallelujah. Is that great? God has been that good to us. Amen. Hallelujah. I know you're all looking for that short message, which I have no faith for. It's good to have Brother Nick Jones and Rylan and baby. What's the baby's name? Joey? Zane. Oh, okay. Close. It was close. I'm trying to get someone to name their kid after me, but there's still hope. Joseph is a good Bible name. It's a good Bible name. I want you to open up to Matthew chapter 2. Before we do, the scripture Laurel was sharing in Luke chapter 1, if you go down, keep reading to verse number 37, 36, Mary says, "How can this thing be?" And the angel of the Lord said, "For with God, nothing is impossible." Nothing is impossible. And that word nothing is a compound word in the Greek. There's three different words there. It's no, not one, rhema, is impossible, powerless, impotent, weak. You put that whole thing together, Not one word from God is powerless. That's what it means when God's saying nothing is impossible with him. Amen. His word is true. If he gave you a word, it's true. Amen. And you can go to the bank on it and trust the Lord in that. Amen. Hallelujah. So I want to read the traditional Christmas story is normally Luke chapter 2, hallelujah, 1 and 2. But I want to go into Matthew chapter 2 and talk about the Magi because I want to get in touch with my Oriental roots. Hallelujah. Very subtle. Don was talking about there's a song coming this morning. It's going to sound like camels going through the desert. It's like, okay, well, there we go. Hallelujah. So Matthew chapter 2, starting with verse number 1, it says this. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. The word there, wise men, is translated magi. Okay? Magi is a word where we get the term magicians, but they were more than that. They were astrologers. They were scientists. And one of the main things that they did was they interpreted dreams. That was one of their main effects. And also one of the things that the Magi did, and these was a political and religious system stemming way back in the Babylonian time, the Magi were kingmakers. They would come together and say, okay, this is who the king should be, and they would lend their agreement to them. And so Acts chapter 8:18 talks about Simon the sorcerer. The word there, sorcerer, is mageo. It's the root word for magi. It was Simon the magician. It was the same deal, same use there in Acts chapter 18. They were religious. Marco Polo, by the way, wrote in his diary that he came across a village in Persia where the villagers said the three wise men came from that place. Do you know that? There was a historical place where Marco Polo came across, said, hey, the three wise men came from this village and went to see the Christ child. Pretty amazing, isn't it? He gave them names. They had names for them. It was Melchior, Balthazar, and Caspar. You ever wonder where those names came from? Hallelujah. Now, the Eastern Orthodox, their tradition is there was more than just three guys. There was 12. It was more than just three guys on three camels. It was this huge entourage, which it probably was. Okay, coming into Jerusalem, three guys didn't just travel alone. They probably came with an entourage and armed guards and what have you. These were prevalent men. And they brought the tradition of these three wise men, they brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And their thought was this, if the child receives the gold, he's going to be a king. If he receives the frankincense, he's going to be a priest. If he receives the myrrh, he's going to be a healer. Isn't that amazing? What insight, right? And when he rolls in, guess what? Jesus grabs all three. He says, I'll take that, and I'll take that. Isn't that amazing? So he rolls into Jerusalem saying, where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him. Now, what's he talking about, his star in the east? Well, this was prophesied in Numbers 24:17. It says that there shall be a star out of Jacob and the scepter out of Israel. It's interesting that this prophecy comes from Balaam. Someone hired Balaam to curse Israel. And he goes, hey, I'll take your dough, but when I get up there and start prophesying, whatever God tells me is what I'm going to say. Okay, so Balak pays the man, and he stands up there, and all he could do is bless Israel. I hired you to curse Israel. You hired me to prophesy what God says. And in the midst of this enemy trying to curse Israel, the prophetic words of the Messiah comes out. Isn't that how God does it? In the midst of what was intended for evil, the word of the Lord comes forward of what good shall come, not just for you, but the whole nation of Israel. And that's Numbers 24:17. In 16:4, woo, glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, man, we got to hurry. Beat the people to lubies. 1604, hallelujah. Kepler Johann Kepler calculated that there was a, a star alignment, hallelujah, between Saturn and Jupiter around 7 BC, and propagated that this was probably the Star of David. Yeah, he figured that, Star of Bethlehem. And this is way back in 1604 he figured this out. That's what was in the sky. You know, there's a cool video going on. You can watch it on YouTube. Talk about the Star of Bethlehem. And this guy goes through. I don't know if you've seen it. It's really kind of an amazing study. The star system is so precise, it's like a clock. Right? That's how we know we could send a rocket out into space and it runs into whatever planet you're looking for. You know, it's pretty amazing how we do that. And the reason why is because the solar system is so precise. Well, the reason why we can look forward and project, hey, in 3 years you're going to hit this planet, in 7 years you're going to hit this planet, the same way you can do that, you could rewind it backwards. And you can know where stars and planets were at any date in history. And now they've done that with computer programs. Now you can find that during the time, hallelujah, about 6, 7 BC, there was this an alignment of planets that would have been the brightest thing in the sky. Pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. They figured all this out. So my thing is, how did these He starts teaching them that unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. He shares with him the Micah 5:2. Those were all written already while Daniel was in Babylon. You know, Josephus tells us that Daniel, in his old age, when the Medes and the Persians came in with Cyrus, that Daniel rolls up to Cyrus with a scroll of Isaiah and opens up to, well, there was no chapters back then, but opens up Isaiah. And reads Isaiah 45 that says, I called you my anointed one, Cyrus. He begins to read Isaiah 45. Say, God brought you to this place to reign and rule. And Cyrus makes him in charge again, Daniel, who was an old man, and gives a decree to the beginning of the rebuilding of Jerusalem. Hallelujah. See, his name was already in the book. Cyrus's name was already in the book. God already had a plan for him before he even showed up on the scene. Right? Isn't that right, Laurel? God had a plan before he even showed up on the scene. Verse number 3, when Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with them. Now, why was Herod troubled at this news? Well, there's a couple of things. Need to know a little bit of history. Herod's father, hallelujah, Antipater, Imedian was his name, was in charge of that area. And that area of Jerusalem was fought between the Romans and the Parthians for many years. The Parthian Empire, or part of the land, was like East Turkey all the way to Pakistan, all the way down Saudi Arabia right in there. That was all the Parthians, and they would fight over Jerusalem. Matter of fact, Herod's father was sent back to rule over Jerusalem and was murdered. And Herod was set there and got driven out because the Parthians invaded again, ended up going back to Rome. And while he was in Rome, he went to the Senate and convinced them to put him in charge. And he said, okay, you can go back as a tetrarch, as a king, and we're giving you the title King of the Jews. So Herod rolls in about 39 AD, BC, takes over Jerusalem and rules with an iron fist all of Judea, right? And rules for 30-some, almost 40 years. And then these guys roll in and say, hey, where is he who's born King of the Jews? I'm King of the Jews. The Senate said, I'm King of the Jews. You getting the background here? You getting why he was so paranoid? And by the way, the Magi, they knew the Magi in the Parthian Empire were the kingmakers. They would come and give their yes and amen to who the king was going to be. So all of a sudden, you're saying, wait, that's who I am. But you're saying there's another? So Herod, it was said that it was better to be a dog in the house of Herod than to be a family member, because Herod loved to kill off his family members. He was that paranoid. Hallelujah. And verse number 4, it says, and when they had gathered all the chief priests and the scribes and the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. Now, they knew there was something going on in history. They knew it was getting close to the time of the Messiah. And when they said unto him, Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it was written of the prophet, for thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come the governor, and shall rule the people of Israel. They're quoting Micah 5:2. Bethlehem is where the Messiah is going to come, right? That was the hometown of David. It was a root. The Messiah was going to come from the root of David. So it had to be in Bethlehem. By the way, tradition holds that the angels that came at night, you read about it in Luke chapter 2, the angels that came and announced to the shepherds were sitting in the fields of Ruth and Boaz. Isn't that cool? The announcement came to shepherds who were sitting in the fields of Ruth and Boaz. Don't tell me that who you marry isn't important for the future. Come on. Don't tell me if you're stuck in a Babylonian system, hallelujah, that you standing up and representing the kingdom of God won't make a difference down the road. What good is it to be in charge of the Magi? These are a bunch of pagans, a bunch of heathen. If you're serving God and doing what God tells you to do, when he tells you to do it, where he tells you to do it, it has an effect in the future. Has an effect in the future. Verse number 7, and Herod, when he privily called the wise men to him, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. He says, okay, when did you start seeing this star? When did this start to happen? Now, like I said, they've began to know that this was something, a period of time where the Messiah was supposed to be coming. Now, Daniel in Daniel chapter 9 talks about the 70 weeks that are on Israel, and this many years are going to happen. Each week is there's a whole big thing. Each week is a seven-year period. If you do the math, 490 years or 483 years, they knew the Messiah. It was almost time for the Messiah. And Daniel quotes, prophesies in Daniel chapter 9, from the going forth of the rebuilding of Jerusalem to the coming of the Messiah is this amount of time. Okay? Hallelujah. Now, some guys have done the math. And there's all kinds of, which decree? There was 3 or 4 or 5 different decrees, one from Cyrus, one from Darius, a couple from Artaxerxes. If you go from the decree from Artaxerxes, 445 B.C., and you do the math because they did 360 days instead of 365, all that kind of stuff, you end up at March 30th. Let me get this right. March 30th, 33 A.D., which just happens to be Palm Sunday. Just happens to be. From the time of the decree of the rebuilding of Jerusalem to the coming of the Messiah, Palm Sunday, Jesus rolling into Jerusalem. They knew Messiah was coming. They knew it. He was coming. because they knew the book of Daniel. Verse number 8, and he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go, search diligently for the young child, and when you have found him, bring word again, and I may come and worship him also. You know he's not going to do that, right? We knew he's not going to do that. And when they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. Now, verse number 11, here's the meat of it. Now, by the way, this is sometime later. They're no longer in a stable, okay? They're in a house, okay? Verse number 11, and when they had come into the house, this is a little while later. Some people say up to a couple of years later when the wise men roll in. You have their birth in Luke chapter 2. Now, by the time you get to Matthew chapter 2, he's already in a house. And when they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, they fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened up their treasures, they presented their gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Let me break that down just a little bit. They came to the house and they saw a young child. The word here is Padian. That's where Star Wars gets Padawan. Young child, hallelujah. A learning child. So this was no infant. This was someone a little older, right? And Mary, he was with his mother Mary. And when they saw Jesus and his mother, they fell down and they worshiped. Let me tell you, this is the natural progression when you really see Jesus. When you really see Jesus, when you're really in his presence, there's nothing you could do but just get on your face and worship him. The word here, worship, is proskuneo. It means to lay on the floor face down. It means to lap at the hand of the master. Humble worship. Total adoration. And that's what these magi, these wise men did. When they really see Jesus, guys, when we really see Jesus, the only thing that overwhelms us is love and appreciation for him. Hallelujah. There's none of this coming in there and just, I'm going to come in there and tell Jesus all my problems. Hallelujah. He'll listen. But when you come with the right heart, the natural response is to worship. And that's what they did. They came in and they worshiped him at his feet. And when they had opened up their treasures, the word treasure here is thesaurus. Now, what's a thesaurus? It's a what? A book of synonyms, right? It's can we call a thesaurus a multitude of expressions? Would that be fair? Hallelujah. A multitude of, when they opened up their multitude of expressions. You see the picture? They came in, they worshiped, they opened up their multitude of expressions, and then they offered gifts. They offered their gifts. After they opened up all their expressions of worship. Hallelujah. Whatever God wants. If he wants you to cry, cry. If he wants you to laugh, laugh. If he wants you on the floor, get on your face. If he wants you to jump, shout. Whatever is a multitude of expression towards him. That's what happens when you see Jesus. And then they offered gifts. Then they offered gifts. Hallelujah. You see, the gifts, those are the last things that we bring. Our worship, our expression, that all comes before. And then we give our gifts. Gold, because he's a king. Frankincense, because he's a priest. And myrrh, for his death and burial. All three of those. And the tradition is that Jesus didn't pick one. He grabbed them all. Hallelujah. Jesus loved Christmas presents. Isn't that amazing? He took them all. So as we come to Jesus during this season, as we remember Jesus in this season, just know to bring your worship first. Bring your expression next. And bring your gifts last. There's nothing wrong with gifts. But that comes on the backside of everything else that already is coming out of our hearts. Amen? God used these heathens. These were Gentiles. These were not people of promise. To come and make aware the political and religious people, the system, hey, the Messiah's here. Messiah's here. Hallelujah. Sometimes we need to wake up. God is not just speaking to the church. He's speaking to the whole world. He's speaking to the world. I am amazed at some of the reports that I'm hearing about how God's showing up in dreams. He's showing up in visions to people and saying, I'm Jesus. I'm your Lord. Hallelujah. How will they know? Jesus is showing up to them and saving them. Amen. Hallelujah. He is the King and worthy of all of our expression, all of our worship, and all of our gifts. Amen. Hallelujah. All of you should have a candle with you. I'd like us to dim the lights. The Bible says that Jesus quotes, he says, I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world. And if you follow me, you will not dwell in darkness, but you will have the light of life. There is a light in life that happens. As we light our candles, I'd ask you, when your candle's lit, just keep it straight up and let the person next to you light come off of your candle. If you tilt it one way or the other, you'll pour wax everywhere. Just let the person, if your candle is lit, hold it straight and everyone else can reach over and get your light. Hallelujah. Go ahead and turn them off. Amen. Will you all stand with me?
Pray. let us adore. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore in Christ the Lord. Oh, come. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. For you alone are worthy. Oh, you alone are worthy. Oh, you alone are worthy, Christ.
Light of life, the light that Jesus brought, that we all share, shines into this dark world. Though darkness cover the earth, though gross darkness, yet your light will shine. And men will come to the brightness of your shining. The Christ in you is what they see. We bless you. We bless your families. We pray as you celebrate our Lord's birth, hallelujah, that you remember that he is the reason. We celebrate him and how we get to participate with him as brothers and sisters of the resurrection. Amen. Bless you in the name of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Hug on three necks before you go. Have a Merry Christmas. Let me...